Okay, today's session, right, I will actually share with you all how to actually look whether at this current market, is there a chance of an en bloc? And if there's a chance of en bloc, what are the possible projects that might have chance of en bloc? All right, so I'll be looking at these two points. Okay, a bit of my background. Okay, I'm actually the co-founder of PropertyNet.sg. We have started since 2013. Basically, we are writing a lot of property blogs, giving a lot of feedback on land prices, probable land project launch prices, and things like that. Okay, so basically, that was my passion in the past, and actually, it has been since then until now. I'm still very passionate about writing all these kind of blogs. Okay. At the same time, I'm also actually a real estate practitioner myself. Okay, I'm an agent. Okay, disclaimer on these talks. Okay, I'm actually writing on behalf, in my personal opinion, okay, using propertynet.sg as my credentials. Basically, all my facts and figures are all from URA. Okay, the source are from URA and Business Times. Okay, just in April, May itself, okay, if you've been following the news, okay, you start to see a lot of en bloc articles, en bloc news coming into the newspapers. Okay, usually when we look at newspapers, if you agree with me, news on the papers are always laggard, okay, in terms of the market sentiments, okay. When we read the news at time, it is actually already happening, okay. So let me just run through some of the news, okay. So basically, there are a lot of en bloc actions on even smaller scales. A lot of agents trying to pitch for en blocs in the current market, and just to be realistic, en bloc, even though the payout might be very good, but as competition grows, agents are also cutting their own comms to actually clinch the en bloc deal. So actually this whole thing is getting a bit not so healthy in my sense. I felt that it has been getting, I mean, even agents doing a successful en bloc, they are not getting that much of payout as per last time, right? Okay, look at this. Just May itself, May the 4th of May. Hey, even like all these old buildings or having all these cracks and all these issues, and this is going for the fourth time. Okay, and developers, it just May the 6th. Okay, developers' margins are being squeezed and all the construction costs going higher. All right, the only positive one in the month of May, the 8th of May, is actually this Maxwell House, okay, being successfully on block in their second attempt. All right. Okay, why I felt the en bloc craze might be back soon, okay? Basically, now we do see less government land sales, all right? Partly, the government felt that the COVID situation is not that well, so they are not going to launch as much land as the past, okay? So what is happening now is we do have stocks depleting, okay? Our vacancy rates are dropping, okay? Meaning, maybe less vacancy, empty units, or a lot already rented out. And the supply is in the pipeline is coming down. Okay, basically, next few slides, I will show you all this data. Okay, so current government land sales. This one, as a real estate agent, right, you can actually go into URA website. Okay, the link is below in my screen here. Okay, you can check what are the upcoming government land sales. Okay, looking at it is really very little. Okay, and the number of units per plot is actually very, very low also. Okay, and we look at the stocks and vacancy of this private residential. Okay, this is actually the first Q URA release. So actually the residential vacancy rate and stock is depleting as well. Okay, and the total number of unsold private residential units in the pipeline is also depleting. Okay, and you look at the pipeline supply, or look at the number from year 2023 onwards, because of the lower government land sales. And the last 2-3 years already no on block already. So the supply is actually coming down. Okay, so when I look at the numbers, like that, right? All these are indicators that the next on block wave should come in soon, right? Okay, so we look at the historical on block sales. In the past, if you look at these on blocks, I would say it's just like a cycle. So we have in 2005, then 2010, then the 2017. Okay, so this wave is coming back real soon due to the lack of government land sales. Okay, if you look at the district of the highest probability of this on block one, okay, you will see that it is like 9, 10, 11, 15, 19. Okay, basically all these are the more matured districts whereby they have projects that are already more than 40 years old, 40 plus 50 years old. That's why the on block wave will hit them much earlier than the newer ones. All right, because the newer ones will have still in very good condition. The people staying there don't have the push factor to actually move out. It's only the very old ones whereby you have the leakages problem or nobody renting your units. Then you actually think of calling for everybody for this collective on block sales. Okay. Above are all the indicators that the next on block craze will be coming soon. And now the issue is this. How do we actually spot an on block project? Okay. Basically, I have these five simple pointers to help you to actually spot some of the on block projects that will have a higher chance of higher chance of transacting it. Okay. Basically, I'm not going to go very in depth into how an on block procedure or process is going to be, but basically with these five pointers, we will say whether this project got a high chance of on block or not, just by these five pointers. Okay, I'll go through more in depth, the age of property, the existing owner's profile, okay, any change in master plan, okay, any major transformation, freehold 99, and the reasonable asking price. Okay, for the age of property, okay, of course, the older, the better, as the profits of the owners will definitely be higher, okay, because the price that they paid for in the past is very, very cheap, okay? So when they actually on block currently, they will be like three times, four times what they have paid for earlier, okay? And the older it is, the more push factors for the owners to let go, okay? There'll be a lot of interfloor water seepage issues, leakages from external walls, okay? And then when it's very old, facilities are very old, it'll be harder for tenants to come in, okay? Because tenants want something new. If you look at all those newer TOP projects, their rental is actually very fast. All the tenants from the older developments will all go to a newer development just by changing. Once the lease is end, they will change to a newer one. So that's common. It's a human thing. So the older properties, right, will only go, the rental will actually go lower and lower, lower and lower, just to keep the mortgage running. Okay, so as long as the property is very old, 30, 40 years old, those kind of properties, you will start to see that the push factor for the owners to let go is higher, all right? And especially the 99 years, these holds, okay, they are pressed for time, all right? They will definitely want to let go. Okay. Next, this one is actually the owners. Okay, one condo itself, right? We need to actually analyze who actually owns, what is the percentage of foreigner and those owned by companies percentage, okay? If you look at these two screenshots, okay, on the left of your screen, you can see one that is owned by Singaporean about 78.9%. Okay, the other one owned by Singaporean is about 57.2%. Okay, basically for on block that are more than 10 years, okay, we need to get 80% consensus before we can call for on block exercise. Okay, so if you look at all the projects first thing we check, is it old enough? If it's old enough, next is we need to check whether there's the existing owner's profile, is it easy to convince them to actually go for this on block? Okay, if you happen to see one that is with, on my right, which is you see company own about 10%, foreigner 70%. Okay, once you see this, that means the percentage of foreign entity will be more than about 30%. Okay, so when you see this, usually it'll be harder because those that owned by company, they might actually just leave it there for their staff to stay. So they will not want to actually en bloc. Okay, they are not supportive of en bloc. And those owned by foreigners, sometimes they are even harder to reach out to them because they are in their country and there's no way to actually get in contact with them to actually ask them to do the en bloc. Okay. So it is only those that is lesser than 20%, then it'll be easier because once we hit 80%, okay, even though you have foreigner component, the moment strata data board say, okay, once this whole thing is gone through and there's a developer coming in to buy, so it's easier for strata data board to actually process and actually approve the sale, all right? Okay, next will be the transformation. Okay, for this transformation, we need to be, okay, for those on-block agents, right, they'll be very sensitive to all the changes in the master plans. Okay, for the master plans, I mean, if you're interested to see, this link, right, will actually bring you to all the past master plans. Okay, you can see all the way back until 60s, all the master plans are there. So every time there are changes to the location, okay, the surroundings, then people be looking at plot ratio, okay, or the transformation, or the change of use to the land. Okay, that will actually create more value in the land itself. Okay, and this next one on the fourth point here is actually the freehold and 99. Okay, as we all know, freehold is definitely more expensive. Right, freehold is more expensive. Agree? Yes. Okay, so 99 years is definitely cheaper. So when we look at it, okay, in order to have a successful on block, right, we also need to know, okay, that the developer themselves, they are also a buyer. Okay, they also have their own risk assessment. Okay, if I buy a freehold at this price, and just nice if neighboring, there's another prop 99 year lease. Okay, also want to go for on block. Most prop, I will choose the 99 year leasehold. Okay, because the risk, the amount of money I put in to buy the land is lower. Okay, so in that way, it lower my risk. Okay, so I'll go for 99. All right, because we must remember one thing, developers are earning from redevelopment. Okay, they earn from redevelopment, they only earn that margin when they redevelop. Okay, so the margin, be it they buy a freehold or they buy a 99 year, okay, the margin is more or less the same. All right. So usually for risk wise, they will actually go for 99. All right. If you monitor the last on block wave, the percentage of 99 is about 70%, and 30% of those that are freehold on block. So it's 70-30. All right. 70% of those are 99. Okay. The last point here I want to share is reasonable asking price, all right? Because everybody knows that on block is definitely good. Okay, the owners will definitely earn a lot of money from it, all right? Hey, developers are willing to pay a premium to get everybody, I mean, to purchase the whole building, okay, from the owners itself. But they also need to have their profit margins. Okay, so if they buy from you at a high price, how are they going to sell? They also need to think about it. So usually when we see those on block, right, the selling price is very reasonable. All right. If you compare to government land sales, basically those are the budget they are willing to actually spend to get to acquire the land. All right. So from there we can actually have a good gauge whether this project can be on block or not, because some of it, like those very big projects, I don't know the name which project, but some very big land parcel, the moment the quantum price cross 1 billion, 2 billion, this kind of scale, buyers, as in the developers, are less eager to come in because the risk is really too high for them. Yeah. Okay, just to give a quick summary. So basically, if you want to spot a good on block project, okay, basically, each of property will be one of the key indicator, okay? Because the age of property will actually make the owners more willing to let go, all right? The older it is, the better, all right? And then the second point is actually the owner's profile, right? Less than 20% foreigners will be better, okay? Third, transformation. Fourth, the 99 years, all right? Acquisition cost, which is lower for them, which is better. And then the lastly is the asking price. Basically, developers are like buyers, okay? They also want to buy something that is cheap, buy something that they can redevelop and earn much more from it. So usually that's actually the key point, how the developers actually look into en bloc. But not all en bloc they will buy, right? So being the owners of this old development, they also need to be very, very careful, okay? Don't be over ambitious and then go and ask a very big quantum price. And then sometimes I felt en bloc agents doing en bloc should actually advise the owners, all right? Don't ask for a lion share of the sales, okay? Basically, everybody want to earn the money. So reasonable market value, I think it'd be easier for a developer to come in, right? Okay, I think I've come to my end of my presentation. Okay, if you have any questions pertaining to en bloc, or you have any developments that you are aware of, or you are staying in that old developments, right? Okay, do feel free to PM me, okay? I can actually link up with you all to those en bloc teams that can actually do feasibility studies, whereby we will actually let you know whether the chances of en bloc, is it there or not, okay? So do feel free to PM me. All this will be confidential, okay? No worries, okay? And usually there's a cut for a referral. So no worries. We can actually take it offline and we can discuss from there. Okay, so okay, before I end, do like and follow us on Facebook. All right, this is my QR code to the Facebook page. Okay, I will also upload this latest article in by this week. All right, so you all can actually read up from there, then we can actually interact more from there. And moving forward, I will come back with more topics, and I hope that, if you have anything of your interest, do drop me a private message, all right? I will actually discuss with you offline, all right? Thank you very much.